I'm Quentin Hardy, executive editor of Forbes, and I will be your moderator for today's program. And now, it is my pleasure to introduce our very special guest, Les Hinton, CEO of Dow Jones and Company. Leslie Hinton's career of nearly 50 years is one of the most extraordinary in modern journalism. Born in Britain, when he was 15, his family emigrated to Australia, where he began as a copy boy on the Adelaide News. This somewhat obscure regional paper was run by a 28-year-old named Rupert Murdoch. Hinton has never worked for anyone else, participating closely in the creation of what is today one of the world's largest media conglomerates, News Corporation. He has been both a reporter on Britain's Sun during its most pneumatic Page 3 heyday and chief executive of News International, overseeing properties including the erudite Times Literary Supplement. A U.S. citizen since 1986, Hinton has worked in this country as a foreign correspondent, magazine publisher, and the chief executive of Fox Television. The long and close relationship he formed with Murdoch over these years, steering coverage, shaping businesses, and putting out fires, has won him such titles as the Consigliere and Murdoch's Special Envoy on Earth. Since 2007, Hinton has been chief executive of Dow Jones & Company, publisher of the Wall Street Journal, a global purveyor of news and business information to businesses and consumers via newswires, magazines, newspapers, conferences, and an increasing range of digital distributions. It is on those future models of news production and consumption, along with the present and future state of journalism, that we will speak today. Please welcome Les Hinton.
Thanks very much for that kind and painfully detailed introduction. When I get introduced these days, as it goes on, I can feel my bones beginning to creak. But it's good to be here. Thank you very much, Quentin, and thank you very much for inviting me. So I'm, as you heard, I'm originally a journalist by training and experience, and I have to say, more experience than training. Learning by experience is a lucky circumstance in the 21st century because information, the core, of course, of the journalism business, is impatient today. You can't really train effectively for something changing so rapidly. And even now, every year, I look back on the previous year and think how ignorant I was about it all a year ago. And every year it's the same. Things keep changing so rapidly. Because information in this digital century doesn't wait around for us to figure it what it is, what it means anymore. It's expanding its dimensions in every direction: volume, speed, clarity, and confusion. Information today is accelerating perhaps beyond our capacity to consume it efficiently, but it's changing things profoundly. I was reading at the weekend a new book by James Glick called The Information, which is fascinating, but he paints a picture which had never quite occurred to me in this way, that essentially the information connectivity now has become the world's global nervous system. And it's already apparent that digital is the real story to differentiate the history to come from the history that's been. It's irrelevant whether tweets will be the hieroglyphics of this age. What matters is the ever-expanding exchange of content and the potential it has to instruct us and to mislead us. It's only natural that as CEO of Dow Jones and publisher of the Wall Street Journal, that I would want to talk to you today about information, about its impact and power in this age of speed, mobility, and choice, about what it's worth, about its value and its cost, and also about its limits. Everything we know about news and information is changing. What it is, where it comes from, how we consume it, and what we can trust. To measure how big this change is, consider that we humans generated more information last year than in all our previous history. By the end of this year, humankind will have stored in digital form the equivalent of 40 tons of printed reading material for every man, woman, and child on Earth. And this scale is clearly hard to grasp. Information comes in all forms, from thousands of terabytes of stored music and video to a half a megabyte book. And look at the dramatic visible signs of how the world is changing. Twitter didn't exist 5 years ago. Now it's among the most important ways that people communicate. More than 100 million tweets, those 140-character info nuggets, are transmitted every single day. The Huffington Post, 6 years ago, did not exist. It's sustained significantly by bloggers and aggregated news from other sources. In February, AOL paid a breathtaking $315 million to buy it. Most significant of all, though, is technology and communication are increasingly more mobile, and the tipping point is probably just a few years away. Morgan Stanley predicts that by 2015, more people will access the internet from phones and other mobile devices than from desktop computers. Understanding what all this change means is clearly profoundly important, and not just for organizations like Dow Jones and the Wall Street Journal. It's vitally important to all of us. This isn't just a matter for news media. It's clear we have a world of information at our fingertips. But how do we harness all this information effectively and efficiently? Now, not every link is worth following. Not every source deserves our trust. In a knowledge economy where commerce is driven by ideas, no business can take a haphazard approach to information. Every business needs sources it can trust, sources capable of providing real news and data to inform decisions and guide directions. It doesn't matter what you make, sell, or service. If you don't have the right information, if you don't know how and where to find it, you can't succeed. Information is the essential raw material of business. Throughout human history, progress has been about our ability to produce, disperse, and connect information. The cross-pollination of ideas, observations, and knowledge is central to how we grow as communities, as companies if you're involved with running one, and as individuals. The more opportunities there are to connect ideas and information, the more quickly we can achieve insights that make progress possible. Now, this concept seems almost entirely self-evident, but it helps explain one of the most important and enduring mysteries about the history of our species. The mystery was this. Humans have used tools for almost 2 million years. For most of those years, not much changed. We were basically predatory apes using a handful of crude tools for basic tasks. Then suddenly, 45,000 years ago, humankind began transforming itself into a dominant species capable of creating culture, exploiting agriculture, building cities, and improving its quality of life by constantly inventing new things. For years, evolutionists looked for some change in the human brain, some genetic mutation or neural breakthrough that would explain what turned us into a race of innovators and inventors. And an explanation finally emerged, and it's a social theory called collective intelligence. Now, the idea of collective intelligence has been used by academics, economists, and communicators, theorists, to understand the evolution of ideas and to explain why the pace of human progress is related to the amount of interaction that takes place among individuals. It's an idea I came across in an article in the Wall Street Journal by Matt Ridley. He's a journalist and science writer, and it's at the heart of his new book, The Rational Optimist. And it turns out that the rapid improvement in hunting tools that marked the beginning of sustained human progress occurred in an area of Western Asia that had an unusually dense population. And it wasn't that those particular beings had bigger brains. It's that they lived in close proximity, which led to a greater interchange, a greater collective intelligence. And it's not a coincidence that throughout human history, centers of progress and innovation have always been areas where people concentrated. and we're close to one now. Silicon Valley is more than just geography. It has been a model for the modern realization of collective intelligence that has been emulated the world over. Today, thanks in no small part to San Francisco and this region, we find ourselves poised to make a quantum leap in our ability to create and exploit collective intelligence. But what happens now that collective intelligence no longer depends on our physical proximity to each other? What happens as our collective human intelligence is amplified by a collective machine intelligence that understands what each one of us is interested in, that maps those interests to information and opportunities scattered throughout the world in seconds? What happens when our connections aren't tethered to offices or homes? This is the essence of the sweeping technological revolution that is occurring right now. We can use vast computing power to discover patterns and connections. New tools will automate the process of linking what we know with what we care about and with what is happening in the world that we may not know about and what we need to know about. Patterns that we may not be able to detect on our own will be highlighted for us. Possible courses of action will be suggested and even carried out on our behalf. Now, we are still in the early formative years of what is happening, but in some ways, it is nothing new. Almost 80 years ago, T.S. Eliot wrote in The Rock, "Where is the wisdom we have lost in knowledge? Where is the knowledge we have lost in information?" What will matter above all is connecting to knowledge and wisdom in ways we can gain from. And if this new form of collective intelligence is based on the magnifying impact of technology, it is also fired by human insight and experience. It is still the creativity and inspiration of individuals that make competitive advantage possible. And it is still what marks the difference between success and failure. It will be human ingenuity that must meet the challenge of bridging the gap between having all this information and making useful sense of it. In the real and practical world of business, this is the essence of what gives information value, because knowledge alone is not automatically power, never mind the old saying. And the essential additional ingredients are these: gaining knowledge with speed, having it before others, discovering the information that you didn't know you needed, and knowing how to make use of what you have learned. Information providers like Dow Jones are pioneering new business models that focus on innovations that lie at the intersection of technology and information. But it will remain the narrative power and the commitment to truth of journalists that will help us make sense of the world we live in. Journalists facilitate the conversation. We investigate and disclose. We curate and illustrate. We prompt the collective intelligence by helping to set the agenda and bring information from the depths to the surface. Now, that used to be a once-a-day process. Your morning newspaper covered the events of the 24 hours before. Then the internet's initial iterations changed the deadline from daily to all day. Yet news consumption at the dawn of digital was still proximate. Much as an earlier generation gathered around the radio to hear the news, news via the internet required a static connection. Even laptops with wireless connections weren't geographically liberating. It still required proximity to a wireless hub. And mobile seems to be changing everything. Not only has it made communication, news and information an anywhere opportunity, mobile seems actually to be transforming our news and information habits. It's early, of course, and the evidence is more qualitative than quantitative, but already we are discerning some definite trends. The Journal's app for tablet computers debuted on the same day that the first mass market tablet came out. We've had a year to watch what happens after the download. In fact, because we charge for access to the journal on any platform, we've been able to understand the behavior of many thousands who've chosen to subscribe via tablets. And what we found is that tablet users report they buy fewer print newspapers, magazines, and books, but those same tablet users report they spend more time than before consuming the content of newspapers, magazines, and books. There's even more good news for publishers like the Wall Street Journal. Tablet users say they prefer to read news and other media on their mobile devices than they do on computers. And like newspapers, their tablets are portable, and it's an intuitive reading experience, unlike a website. There's a beginning and an end, and a defined sections to guide their choice and progress. The navigation, whether they flip pages or use menus, is consistent and comfortable. There are no delivery issues, of course. The device and the news are always available. It is a highly visual medium, making pictures and graphics vital to satisfaction. And they even like the way the ads play, which is music to a publisher's ears. Independent research indicates that tablet users derive significantly higher satisfaction from content displayed on their tablets compared with smartphones, which I guess is not much of a surprise. But what this suggests is a change of the sort that occurred when personal computers were introduced. If PCs opened the door to the internet, tablets are taking the information down the digital road. I won't claim to see the first bend in that road. I am, however, willing to admit to some optimism about the future for the news business. Our tabloid edition is barely past its first birthday, and already it is bringing in millions of dollars in incremental subscription and advertising dollars. Even in print, the journal has been able to collect increasing advertising and circulation revenue. And I do not, by the way, join the doomsayers predicting the early death of words on paper. So we, from a financial market niche in the 19th century to the diary of the American dream in the 20th to a more complete global news and business information franchise across multiple platforms, the journal is a more compelling, I think, than it's ever been, but you probably expect me to say that. And it helps promote the collective intelligence of the communities it serves. This is, I think, what represents the power and hope for all serious quality journalism. A lot of people in this audience that are associated with the media know already that when you read respected newspapers, you think about what you read. If you are in the business of selling products and services, you know, many of you, that advertising in a quality newspaper or its website pays off. You know that a positive or negative article on your business, if you're involved in one, has much more impact than one appearing on an obscure blog. Newspapers have long played a central role in the creation of collective intelligence. Newspapers create a community of interest, and the journal extends that community to a global scale. The consumption of news and information will continue to be positively disrupted by technology. For all our hopes and expectations for the mobile platform, we are not so foolish as to believe it's the final technology. But we are leveraging the cutting edge of today's technology to bring news to our readers and customers wherever and however they expect it, and others are seeking to do the same. Some of our business-to-business customers will pay us a great deal of money to receive vital corporate news and economic data at super high speed. Wall Street today trades in microseconds, and information must be just as fast. 15,000 times faster than the blink of an eye, our Wall Street customers can receive and act upon information we feed directly into their trading systems. These days, this super speed is called low latency, but it's interesting looking back that in the news business, there's an eternal race to be first. Julius Reuter, who founded the news agency of the same name, sprung on the idea to use homing pigeons to beat his competition on horseback to get news quicker. The American news agencies would row out to a vessel arriving with news from the old world until some spark got the idea of buying a steam boat that could get out there and get back quicker than the opposition could. So today, Dow Jones connects news with technology to provide custom business intelligence. We have an enterprise called Factiva, which is well known in business, not well known to the general public, but it is a search engine, and it aggregates 31,000 premium sources that are immune significantly from manipulations of search engine optimization. So it's designed for efficiency, not to maximize clicks or ad impressions. So what technology will be conceivable in a few years? What innovation will prompt the behaviors to come? It's easier, I have to say, in the business of journalism to chronicle and explain than it is to hazard predictions. And I'm an old reporter, not a prophet. But what I can tell you is that with certainty is that we will, and all the media business that you all depend upon in different ways, will continue and must continue to pioneer new ways and make sense of a world that is generating more information without necessarily generating more knowledge and understanding. Mobile and tablets are changing our lives. They're connecting the collective intelligence past geography and expanding the opportunity to the web as wide as the world. The key is quality and community. The opportunity will be realized only through the right connections and the appropriate, above all, the appropriate clarity and understanding. Thank you very much indeed for listening.
Now, as we begin our discussion, I need a moment of full disclosure. I worked at Dow Jones for 12 years, and for over a decade, I've been part of a weekly show on Fox News. But that really isn't so surprising, because nowadays it would be rare not to have a career in journalism and bump up against one or two of the increasingly larger media corporations that seem to dominate the landscape. Does that kind of consolidation bother you?
Well, clearly I think the issue of plurality of voice is what matters most of all. The issue of companies that are allowing a diversity of opinion and creativity. And that can extend from the business of journalism, because we're also in the business of movies and television and book publishing. The issue for us is having a broad spectrum of opinion, which we do.
Mm-hmm. And do you feel that the competition from below, in the form of anything from blogs or tweets or locally formed news organizations, is long-term significant?
It's terrifying. I mean, the great liberation of digital is that anyone can communicate anything, anytime, to any person. And while that creates an awful morass of useless information and confusion, it's also, I think, true that we've seen already some clever, penetrating digital ideas. I think the Huffington Post, for instance, is an example. I think that the real power, the unimportant power of what's happened with the power of digital is it is giving everyone a low-cost opportunity, if they've got good ideas, to have a shot in getting to the market.
You feel those business models, like the Huffington Post, kind of counting on a number of free contributors or others hoping for Google ads are sustainable models, or is that going to...
Well, AOL does. They paid more than $300 million for it.
Yeah, what did you think of that price?
I thought it was a rich price, and I think Ariana must be very happy that it was paid.
Well, no question.
But to address the point you were making earlier on, and I think it's really important. If you go back, I'm an old digital seer from 15 years ago, 20 years ago, called George Gilder.
Yeah.
And he painted a picture then he said, this is the state of modern communications. And he just drew on his chalkboard a pyramid. He said, you've got very few people at the top here who make the decision about what everyone else will see and know and learn. And he said, what is going to happen is that pyramid is going to be coming completely inverted, and that you'll be in a position where one person can sit there and use the web to discover, to travel across virtually infinite sources of information. And that is what's happened. So it's an opportunity. If you're running a big business that's dependent upon traditional models, it can be a bit of a pain. But if you're a person interested and an intelligent consumer of it, the diversity, the fact that you can read quality newspapers from anywhere in the world. You can catch up, if you care about it, with what the BBC is saying about the Middle East. You can look what the Australians are saying about Japan. This is an amazing liberation, I think.
Well, it's good news if you're in the information business, and potentially if you're in the truth business. It's also good news if you're in the propaganda business. Now, how do you account for things like the birther movement having such a long lifespan in the national scene?
It's kind of weird, isn't it?
Well,
there are always things to offset the manner in which people communicate. I mean, people used to talk over the backyard fence. They can now use Twitter. There is this insatiable capacity to fill infinite amount of cable news time. The fact is, though, weird as it is, every opinion poll showed, in fact, that quite a substantial number of people thought there may have been some truth to it. And where did that truth begin with? Was it the propagation of it, or was it begun? I mean, and rumors have always generated, haven't they? They generated with early printing and pamphlets, but that is libel and untruths can spread much more easily. But the same mechanism, the same devices, if you think, for instance, about Twitter or Facebook, are part of what played a huge part in what's happened in the Middle East. I mean, there was a lot of truth traveling from person to person as well. It takes a little more than Twitter to create a revolution. I mean, the Americans know that, the French know that, but the truth is it made it travel much quicker.
No, it certainly played a role, and I think one of the interesting ways you could tell that was the despot used to get up and blame the CIA, and now he blames Al Jazeera or perhaps Dow Jones.
But in the old days, when I was a young wire agency reporter, working with a radio station that we owned in Australia, coups in Africa. The first thing that the coup leaders would do would be to occupy the local radio station,
right?
Because that was the only means of communicating. You can't suffocate communication now. You can. I mean, there were great attempts in Egypt of Vodafone being told to bring down their network and stuff. But it's much more liberated.
I think developing an interesting idea in terms of where the value lies in developing a news business nowadays. There was a time in the era of Julius Reuter where you could simply convey data and you get paid for that. Mm. Now data is basically free and you're conveying, what you're vending is trust and insight, essentially. That's the value-added product.
Yes. Well, it's data insofar as it's the data, the statistical, factual, unarguable data, but reporting a truth about a political movement or developments in a business or in a community, truth isn't always a clear thing. So being reliably able to report what's happened is very important as well. I mean, two nights ago when people were getting tweets saying that bin Laden was dead, who would have believed it until you'd read gone immediately to a reliable website, whether it was the Wall Street Journal, whether it was the CNN, you know, it was not believable. And that traveled, just off the track a little bit, I was talking to you earlier, I was listening, some of you may have known this, on one of the cable channels this morning, a chap being interviewed who was at a baseball game, and he got a tweet saying that bin Laden was dead. He told a couple of his neighbors, they didn't believe it, but finally, everyone was getting tweets. And the guys, poor guys who were trying to play baseball, suddenly, within 20 minutes, the entire crowd was singing USA, USA. And the players didn't know what was going on. But the power of that kind of community of contact is fabulous. And in the end, although you can say bad things on a tweet, that's got to be a good and liberating thing.
Let's spend a minute on traditional print, or print as it's seen today anyway. Just today, the Audit Bureau of Circulation came out with the numbers, and the Wall Street Journal.
Let's talk about the numbers.
Yeah, let's spend a minute. I knew you'd like that. We'll spend a minute on the numbers. The Wall Street Journal is now the largest newspaper in America with 2.1 million and up 3 points.
1.5.
USA Today held about even at 1.8, and the New York Times with 900,000 was down about 3.6. How do you account for the performance you're enjoying? What did you do?
I love questions that allow me to be really self-serving. So
go for it. I'll move to something else in a moment.
I'm sure you will, Quentin. But basically, we did what News Corp acquired Dow Jones and the Wall Street Journal in December of 07 with lots of plans to improve it and invest in it. We rode into, as everyone knows, this incredible economic hurricane in 08, especially towards the end of 08. We kept investing. We rebuilt the website. We added pages to the paper. We added magazines. We did a lot of investment in the paper and other things, but the paper most visibly. And two things were happening at the time. We were sustained through advertising, which is predominantly provided by businesses, and they weren't advertising, so that went to hell in a handbasket. But we were the most trusted chronicler of what was happening. So our circulation, our web traffic, went through the roof. And what's happened now, as things, I wouldn't like to be too presumptuous about it, things seem to be getting better. Let's hope we stay on the same track. We've ended up, as you just pointed out, emerging as the newspaper with the higher circulation, digital and print, when we've had six consecutive quarters of advertising growth, and no other newspaper operation can compare with that. And I think we were clever enough or lucky enough to invest when others were cutting back drastically.
So, for those listening on the radio, you're listening to the Commonwealth Club of California radio program, and we're talking with Les Hinton, CEO of Dow Jones and Company. So, in other words, the success you're enjoying now is a combination of new technology, enjoying the fortunes of a crisis, as it were, and a good old-fashioned newspaper war. At the same time, the numbers counted a 23% increase in digital consumption,
yes,
and print itself slipped about 4%. Do you still call that a newspaper when print goes away? And say more about what you said in your speech, that you don't see the print newspaper vanishing.
Well, I hope and believe that the word newspaper will endure, because if you use as a word, it'll start to mean different things. Anyone that uses Microsoft Outlook always sees the opportunity to CC someone, and that, of course, used to mean carbon copy them. Yeah. And when you're editing, you get the chance to cut and paste. And, of course, you don't cut and paste at all. And I think, therefore, the newspaper has a durable part to play as the description of a place of authority and a digestible information. Go on.
Go ahead.
I'm sorry, I thought you may have wanted to...
Well, how does it change the makeup and the staffing to move to an increasingly digital model?
Well, there are a couple of issues. And since you're a journalist, I know when you talk about staffing, you're only talking about journalists. But the truth is that one of the big issues, because newspapers in the traditional print sense, above all, they're big manufacturing and distribution businesses.
Sure.
You truck in paper, you print on the paper on big expensive machines, then you truck the paper out with ink on them. And digital isn't like that. So the marginal cost of adding a single newspaper subscriber is a lot more than the marginal cost, which is very tiny, of adding an iPad subscriber. So the fact is, as this morphs, the need for production and distribution is going to diminish. But the primary thing we do is provide very valuable content, and this is the great important issue that we've got to face. It will become, in lots of ways, less expensive to produce the newspaper, but when you spend, as operations like ours do, hundreds of millions of dollars a year on your journalism, you've got to work out a way of migrating the revenue that you're enjoying in print on paper into the digital world. And some operations are having more success than others. Now everybody is trying. I mean, there was a profound, it's all generally admitted now, but there was a profound mistake made in the mid-90s by almost all newspaper companies. As digital came along, all these people we were talking about with the ability to communicate, create new businesses, the big established newspapers kind of panicked, I think, and gave it all away. There was one notable exception, which my company, News Corp, can take no credit for at all. And in 1995, the then managers of the Wall Street Journal said, we are not going to give this away. So we've been able, luckily, to imbue in people the belief and expectation that you're going to pay for it.
And yet when you came on in 2007, you thought about dropping the
paywall. It was a close thing, Quentin. It was a close thing. We actually did, because it was 07 and things were looking pretty rosy. We thought, well, look, they're foregoing all this advertising revenue. Let's drop down the paywall, but I spent a little bit of time in due diligence looking at the numbers and thought, maybe not.
So it was tough it out.
It was a lucky.
Well, you're lucky because you're in a business newspaper and business people pay for things more than the general public does. Business to business,
yeah.
They pay, they expect to pay.
That has been hitherto the explanation and probably the reason, frankly, that gave Dow Jones in the old days the confidence to do it. But
right now,
big newspapers like the New York Times, newspapers of ours around the world, and many others, the Germans, it's happening all over the world. They're all struggling with ways to warrant their readers and users to pay for what they're reading. And it's a critical thing. And the more people that are doing it, the more I think it is likely to succeed. And there is no clear single model. Even our company, News Corp, we're trying different models.
And of course, the iPad app is an opportunity in some ways to have a reset for many of these people. They feel they can charge for an app. And it's really just a different digital medium.
Well, and some things are, I mean, you know, consumer patterns and predictions are very, very hard to predict. And the one thing that you can say, looking back now, because it's true, that the willingness to pay for digital, for apps, is proving to be strong, not just in reading. And why that's happened is hard to define. You know, if you're as old as I am, you'll remember when you were on the phone at home, you're using the phone being told to get off it because it was costing money. There was, I think, a propensity all along, and it was shown even in early primitive digital SMS text charges and stuff. People were willing to use their mobile. Whether that translation is part of the explanation, I'm not quite sure, but there's been, you know, we have got going on for 200,000 people are either bundle subscribers or unique subscribers to the iPad. On top of that, we've got another 50,000 going on, 50,000 who are subscribing to us on reading.
The iPad apps are great, and they do offer more range. You can embed video, for example. But of course, that also raises the bar in terms of your cost of production. Can you create an app that's priced appropriately? Can you get the advertising revenue up to justify that kind of a more expensive back end of production?
The back end of production, there is cost in developing the app.
Yeah.
But the running cost of actually supplying it. I mean, essentially, for instance, the text on there is repurposed online material. So we actually dedicate, I think, three journalists to the Wall Street Journal app, and their job is in tidying up the way it looks, because you get very weird scanning of type and, mm-hmm. and headlines. And they have other jobs as well. So, and of course, on top of that, if you add we charge the full price is $4 a week, the incremental cost of adding that, the marginal cost, I beg your pardon, of adding that subscriber is very, very small. Mm-hmm. So there's offsets. So there are whole other issues to do with the fact that the big media companies are going to transform. You know, capital spending in the old days was building big presses, depreciating them over 30 years, 20 years. Now it's technology, and the technology, you've got to be relentlessly innovative, because one thing that users of digital want is constant evidence of improvement. So you need to concentrate your resource and develop your expertise in permanently remaining cutting edge in what you're doing.
Right. The new costs in some ways are, well, translation into other languages, because mm-hmm. you're distributing in Japanese and Chinese and
yep.
who knows, maybe Hindi, I don't know.
Hindi, we have blogs in Hindi, Korean.
Okay. So you repurpose to different technologies, different reading devices, you
yep.
repurpose to other languages, but that's also met by a higher cost of personalization and localization.
Yes, yes.
Do you see that affecting the balance?
No, I think the actual cost of digital media compared with the cost of buying the dead trees, shipping them, printing them on big expensive material, employing all the people to make.
Yeah, a minute ago you loved newspapers.
No, but
they're portable. They're graphically interesting.
No. If you want me to the thing about why
I want you to pick.
I don't think there's a need to pick. I think that frankly, if you were running a business and some guy came into you and he said, you know, I've got this great idea, and it didn't exist, you get trees, they grow easily, you can recycle them. And you can crunch it down to this sort of thing. Let's just call it, like, say, paper. And you can print on it. And you can drop it and it doesn't break. It doesn't need a battery. You don't have to reboot it. It's recyclable.
You can charge a ton for ads.
Yeah, you can charge. But that as a vehicle is why I think that paper will actually endure for quite a long time to come.
Yeah. Let's turn to some other.
What I was trying to put to us was your view that somehow providing a digital platform was more expensive.
No.
It's not more expensive.
No, my point was really it changes the staffing makeup. It changes the cash flow. It changes the cost of producing news and gaining that kind of trust and insight. Mm-hmm. How do you rebalance that? Do you have any insight about what a newsroom will look like in terms of what you can afford?
Well, the newsroom we have now, but see, the journal and Dow Jones, we've got just over 2,000 journalists that are in more than 60 countries, and they spread across an entire range of things. We produce very high margin business-to-business products, newsletters. We've just developed a new foreign exchange service. And those people that are working on that, their material is being sold at a very high margin because it's specialized, but it's also usable in every other format. Mm-hmm. So having a range of different products that allow you to repurpose the material that you're generating in different ways is a valuable situation thing to be in. But you know, there's no doubt that managing the migration, which is going to happen at whatever speed we can debate, managing the migration from pure paper to pure digital, which ultimately will happen, that is the great challenge. And there is no one that knows all the answers now. God, I wish I knew the person if they do.
Let's turn to a couple of other interesting technology developments. WikiLeaks. Mm-hmm. What do you make of the influence? Were you ever in contact with Julian Assange? Did you elect to work with him or not?
We had some contact, but I'm not quite sure of what the detail of it was. But if you're asking me about the principle of what...
And would you use
the principle of what Assange did, I find, as an old journalist, and your whole... If you use a single word to describe what journalism is about, it's about disclosure. You know, we're here to tell stories, to communicate. So when you get into the situation that Assange is in with WikiLeaks, where there was a balance between whether he was endangering the lives of people or not, and there's an eternal debate about whether or not he was, because there was quite a bit of care going. I think that, briefly speaking, I think that, in summary, I think he was probably reckless, but I find it hard to condemn the principle of using whatever technology you can to increase transparency. That's the bit.
As a journalist and a publisher, would you have found the material irresistible?
Some of it was great, yes, on the basis it was accurate. And look, WikiLeaks is the first, and there are others, other news organizations, including ours, are looking at ways in which we can develop the same kind of capability.
Say more.
No.
Okay, I'll tweak that slightly. Recently, a sister or cousin publication, the News of the World in London, finally admitted liability in a phone tapping scandal.
I'm very familiar
that
with
had gone. Yes, you were flown to London to try and still the waters a little bit.
I was there when the actual hacking took place. Actually.
Okay. Yeah. What do you make of all that now?
I think there's a lot going on there legally and everything else. So I think it would probably not be a good idea to get into a great deal of detail. But it was a sorry and regrettable episode.
No question.
Yeah.
There are lawsuits. You have a healthy inventory of lawsuits.
There are lawsuits. There are potential, although it's not clear, potential criminal proceedings too.
Right. And do you think that kind of digital percolation, inside or outside the law, a la WikiLeaks or a la this kind of phone tapping, will continue to be a problem?
I think the advance of digital capability and the relentless curiosity of people and journalists in particular, because we're paid to be curious, is going to be an issue. But in the case and in the end, the criteria has always got to be what is in the public interest. If you discover by whatever means something of epic importance, then there's always the argument, however you've discovered it, it needs to be disclosed. But in the case of the News of the World, insofar as the details are clear, these were kind of trivial.
Right. Well, it always comes down. Well, trivial in one sense, not trivial in another. They drive circulation. The News of the World thrives on celebrity and royal news.
Yes, but I'm talking about the ability to justify activity.
Oh, that.
It was clear that
right.
That you're talking about what the public is interested in rather than public interest.
Well, that dominates the newsroom in some cases.
Yeah.
You know, will this drive circulation?
Yeah, of course it does.
What drive your news judgment?
In the end, it's what people. I mean, what people are interested in. That it is proper to print. I think the New York Times sums it up quite well with its slogan. You know as well as I do, Quentin, that you're forever seeing things and making a decision about what is right and wrong to judge. I remember being in the newsroom of one of our newspapers in London, the night that Diana was injured in a car crash, and we had a photograph of her in the back of the seat, and it wasn't clear whether or not she was dead, but there was an increasing belief that she was. And I looked at this picture of her, and she looked actually amazingly fine. Mm-hmm. But I said, you know, we can't run that picture because if she, and this is just a totally, there's no rule book that can guide you on what to do in things like that. But we just couldn't run the picture because of the prospect that she might be dead.
Now, this kind of editorial judgment will never be the subject of an algorithm, a piece of software. It's a human judgment, isn't it, in the end?
Yes.
You can't encode that kind of taste.
You can't, and the truth is that in areas of interrogation or inquisition, newspapers are and journalists are always told to follow ethical rules, but they're also aggressive, and sometimes newspapers pursuing a perfectly legitimate line of inquiry will go over the line.
Right. Now, let's spend a minute on the news business itself. You mentioned something interesting about the New York Times. You've worked in Australia and you've worked in the UK, where the newspapers tend to have strong personalities and strong points of view.
Yes.
And you've worked in the States, where news organizations have at least some pretense to objectivity, all the news that's fit to print, or Fox's fair and balanced. Do you believe in journalistic objectivity?
I Henry Luce, who was no great crusader for objective journalism, as he said that any journalist who thought that he was objective was delusional, and the truth is that presenting both sides of a story is, or that consumers have got can find out both sides of the story is very important, but it is wrong. I mean, the New York Times is a great paper in many ways, but there are many people who believe that even in its news pages, it slants to the left. And that doesn't mean that they're propagating it, because in the end, any journalist who goes to cover a story is presented in that moment when he's got to write 500 words with an infinite selection of facts that he can ask and information that he can include in what he writes. So his ability to the ability to make that judgment without being entirely objective is clearly an issue. But I think in the end, in Britain, there is a rather different among the popular press. There is a rather different tradition which doesn't exist here because it's very much more competitive. And in a way, you could argue that the boisterous popular end of the and middle market of the press, they're kind of descendants of the old Victorian pamphleteers. So they'll get hobby horses and they'll drive really hard about them. But the fact is that no one is under any misapprehension that what you're getting is a coloured view of things.
It's a function of the competition too in the UK.
It may be a function of the competition, but by and large you'll get on any given day a fair range of slant. You with the Guardian, which is a quality newspaper in many ways, is significantly left of centre. The Daily Telegraph is significantly right of centre. But you know what you're looking at. Mm-hmm. And it's when you see examples of deceptive journalism as opposed to openly opinionated journalism that you need to worry.
Mm-hmm. And in a 2004 study, in a surprise to many, many people, it was found that away from its rather vehemently rightward-oriented editorial page, the Wall Street Journal was found to be among the most liberal of newspapers in the United States. Do you think that would still be true today?
I think there is no mistaking the opinion of its editorial pages. Mm. But I think there was a study done after the last election of the presidential election that decided that the most down the middle news coverage of the election had been the journals, and I think the journals' news coverage is very down the middle. Look, I mean, who's to say that we don't occasionally get it wrong? But I think it would be hard, and there are those among our less friendly competitors who look forever at the opportunity to establish that that's been the case. There was a long piece written in the New Yorker, which confessed at the end that for all the allegations, there was very little among competitors with a vested interest. There was very little evidence that the journal had veered away from being down the middle as a newspaper.
I'd like to spend a minute on a lightning round of sort of the great super stories going on right now. How critical do you feel the national debt is as a story and as an event?
I think it's massive, but it is one of those stories that's terribly hard to tell to the mass of the people. Yeah. So they get if you speak, I mean, you can talk about sophisticated audiences, let's include the journal, but the world is not determined just by sophisticated people. What anyone in the street that you talk about is going to say, why do those guys on the hill not sort themselves out? They're fighting, they're cantankerous, they can't agree, and I'm suffering. But it's clearly a big issue.
I had a question from the audience. What advice would you give President Obama on getting the deficit down?
I'll be careful with what I say, but I do think that the issue of spending is clearly a problem. Whether or not taxes are needed is debatable, but clearly the level of spending and how it's grown, I think, is arguable. You know, the whole argument now is about raising the national debt above mm-hmm. $1.3 trillion. It's going to have to be raised, but the Republicans clearly aren't going to allow it to go up without some give back. But that's what, you know, years ago when I first came to this country, reading about Congress, and I was told, I read, Congress is about compromise, compromise, and compromise. Mm-hmm. It's the wonder of it. And in the end, they'll work it out.
Okay. The death of Osama bin Laden and the war on terror, how significant is that?
I don't know. I'd love, I mean, there's this great rush of jubilation, and I personally was a little uneasy looking at some of the celebrations. It's the sort of thing you see on the streets of Islamabad, or mm-hmm. and I didn't personally like that, but it was understandable. But and you'd love to think. I mean, I think it was CNN when I was in my room this morning saying, coming up next, what it means for our troops coming home now that bin Laden is dead. I wish it was that simple.
We all declared game over, huh?
Yeah, well, yeah, victory. In right. fact, I think May 1 was the anniversary of Bush's victory
mission
landing
accomplished.
mission accomplished.
This should have been prophetic.
Yeah,
right?
Yeah.
And the Middle East revolutions, obviously still a work in progress. How significant is it in your view?
Oh, it's profound, isn't it? I the issue is how it's going to whether or not it'll be stymied. What's going to happen in Syria? What will happen with the Muslim Brotherhood, who've just announced that they're going to put up two or three more volume, the volume of seats they're running for in the next election? They claim, and some people believe that they're not so hardline as others think they are. If they were to win, and if they were not to be as they profess to be, how is Israel going to react? Mm-hmm. I mean, there are whole loads of potential chain events. Syria isn't going to go away. What's going to happen there? You know, Bahrain even. It is a real, very unpredictable tinderbox at the moment, I think. Mm-hmm.
And lastly, a question from the audience. Do you feel that the free market and the government can and are coexisting well?
Yeah. I mean, I think that Obama has probably at some point during the banking crisis, when it may have been conceivably politically expedient, was very critical of the bankers, but goodness only knows, they surely deserved some of the opprobrium that's been heaped upon them. But everyone, no one in this country, and it's, look, if you're in Europe, which I know well, you can spend time in very advanced European nations, but in this country, deep in its DNA is a belief in individuals and free enterprise and free markets, I think.
You're listening to the Commonwealth Club of California radio program. We're talking to Les Hinton, CEO of Dow Jones & Company. Yes, for everything the financial crisis of 2008 meant and represented and how much it shocked people, it was striking to me how much everyone essentially around the world was committed to the free market model. Mm. You didn't find anyone saying, well, North Korea has it all worked out.
No. The Chinese became a little triumphalist at one point, though, didn't they?
Yeah, well, their time may come.
Yes, that's an interesting prospect.
Let's talk a little bit about News Corp and the Wall Street Journal. Is News Corp a single brand? Is it a series of brands? How would you describe this brand?
News Corporation is a holding company. So no few people who see a movie that 20th Century Fox has made, they don't even know it's a 20th Century Fox movie, let alone that 20th Century Fox is owned by us. If they're reading a HarperCollins book, they don't even register usually that it's a HarperCollins book, let alone that it's News Corp. So in the end, the company always has worked as a kind of loose federation of global entities, but in the end, it's the brand that touches the consumer that is the one that has that drives its reputation and its success.
And is the cornerstone of what you described as the most valuable thing, that trust element. Mm. The trust is totally wrapped up in the brand. Mm. What is the Wall Street Journal brand now and going forward? The Dow Jones brand, I should say.
The Dow Jones brand is, well, the Dow Jones brand, I mean, the Dow Jones company is basically a powerhouse of content generation, of largely more general than it used to be, but largely specialized. Globally, the trust of it, the quality that we deliver is its success. It is the belief in the quality of what we do that will make us live or die in the digital age.
And that's with Barron's and the Journal and the Newswires and the foreign language editions and does it have too many moving parts?
It has a sufficient number of moving parts. Some of them are moving more smoothly than others. But I think it's not overloaded with moving parts now.
Okay, on the wire service side, you're competing with Reuters and Bloomberg. Handicap the competition. What do they do well that you wish you?
Reuters and Bloomberg are largely marketing services, market services companies. They provide market data. They provide transactional capability for traders of all
highly
sorts.
Highly valuable.
Highly valuable. But in that, and that is where they generate their revenue. We are a content company in a way that they are not. And so for us, what we're trying to do, and that this is, as I was discussing, this intersection between technology and content, it is providing the technology to make this information that we provide, that people trust and want, as usable as possible. And hence the super low latency services that we're providing, the foreign exchange services, when we provide, with our FX operation already, there have been moments when there's been significant movements in currency because of things that we've done.
And as I look at the upper ranks of Reuters and Bloomberg and CNBC and the New York Times now and the Washington Post, it's full of former journal people. Does that bother you?
It's
flat. Spoken of as a diaspora.
You started off by saying that it's hard to have worked in media without having touched News Corp in some way or other, even yourself, Quentin.
Yeah.
It's flattering to see that they value our departed employees so highly.
Seek them, in fact. What did News Corp learn from the MySpace acquisition?
I was not directly involved in the MySpace acquisition.
You're still working there.
I was working there now, but it's a very big company. I can't tell you much about what's going on in Australia or in Mumbai with Star Television.
Okay, well, let's spend a minute on the big boss. How hands-on is Mr. Murdoch?
He is incredibly hands-on. So if I'm walking in the office as I was the other morning, 7:45 in the morning, and tap on my shoulder as we go to the elevator, he's there.
Yes, you once spoke of being in a competitive job that left you in a state of permanent self-apprehension.
Permanent self-apprehension, and
48 years, and you still think you're going to be axed.
51. No, there is no the visualization and paranoia. You never feel secure in your job. But for 51 years, I'm probably wearing a little less than I was 40 years ago.
Smell the barn. Now, what are your instincts about success?
Did you say smell the barn?
You can smell the barn. The horse is going home. What are your instincts about succession at News Corp? Is it as unthinkable as sort of Apple after Steve Jobs or Berkshire after Buffett?
The one thing I can say about News Corp, and I would being one of them, is that there is a very, very deep bench of talent all over the world.
Mm-hmm.
And the company will endure with all the talents that it has on board for many years to come.
But in large companies built and guided by one very strong and insightful person, frequently there is a long period of soul-searching and a kind of poverty of innovation afterward, like Disney after the death of Walt Disney, or Hewlett-Packard after Bill and Dave moved off. Do you worry about that, and how do you guard against that inside News Corp?
I've read the history of these companies. You could talk about Time Inc. after Luce, which in fact did pretty well. In fact, it grew vastly after Luce died. I think this company's got, and in the end, you can overdwell on personalities, and Rupert's been a massive power, and still is. But you just look at the quality of our brands around the world. Mm-hmm. Look at how well they're doing. Look at how well our cable operations are working, our studios. We're in good shape.
We have a few minutes left. Let's spend a minute on your own career. What do you expect to see over the rest of your career in business?
Great success and satisfaction. And the light at the end of the tunnel.
I'm going to scratch that permanent self-apprehension comment now. You appear to be at peace with your self-apprehension. I had an audience question around this. What personal characteristics can you ascribe to your own success?
I don't know. I guess that must have some kind of an instinct for survival. I grew up in a very... and traveled all over the world. So Rupert is in fact a serial immigrant. So I've worked for him all over the world. The ability to drop into new businesses. I dropped into Fox for a while, dropping into Dow Jones. I went back to London to run the newspapers during a period of difficulty there. I think probably, Darwin's theory is not about the survival of the fittest. It's about adapting to change. And I think probably I've adapted to change quite well.
Your ADD has been good to you. Serial immigrant is a very good line. You have children. Are any of them in the industry?
I've got some of them are and some of them aren't, yeah.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
Would you encourage people to pursue a career in journalism?
It depends whether they want to get rich or not. There really is. In the world of journalism and finding out things and meeting people and understanding and traveling, there is no better life I know of than doing that. And of course, advertising, looking around the audience, selling advertising is a very satisfying job as well. but I found it very rewarding. And I, for years when I finally came off the road, I would have these recurring dreams of being in some interesting place. And in those days, you fed your teletype machine with, and I'd be in some place filing, so then I'd wake up and have to go into the office. It took me a while to adapt.
Right. And if you were starting out now, or if someone young was asking you for advice, what are the critical skills that you'd need?
My youngest son graduated a year ago from Boston University. He went to the comm school there, and there are certain things you can't teach people, and I have a limited faith in the ability to teach people formally to be a good journalist. You've got to have energy, you've got to have curiosity, you've got to be unafraid to find things out, you've got to be unrelenting in your inquisition of people, and you've got to be able to put a phrase or two together. But in the end, finding out what we do above all as journalists is publish stuff that other people don't want us to find out. That's what we do above all, and being relentless about that and having an instinct for that is, that's it. But you've got to have, it takes certain personal qualities to be good at that.
Mm-hmm. And you described all this change affecting the business. What is, to your mind, universally true in journalism? What's the thing that won't change in all this?
I intended to say that it is in the end that the world needs really good messengers. We need to be able to know what's going on. We need to know where we can go to understand the confusing, to have the scary things put into context. It is as messengers that we are must succeed. And the fact is, for all the business model quandaries that it provides, the ability to discover and communicate messages now has never been.
How healthy is the industry and the calling? Do we have good messengers? Enough really good messengers?
I think the quality of, over the last 3 or 4 years, when a lot of newspaper groups, big newspaper groups here, entered into some fairly, in the end, imprudent transactions, their instinct, because they were occupied by people that weren't newspaper publishers, was to cut. And what you do is cut the most visible things. They cut bureaus. So a lot of good journalists have gone. I fear that quite a lot of
the big institutional newspapers in the country. And I would not include the New York Times in this, by the way. I think they've maintained their quality very well. A lot of the big institutional newspapers have really depleted their talent.
Well,
and you can, you know, it's the old cycle. When you're bringing in young, bright-eyed graduates, they can be as clever as you like, but unless there's that culture of transition, those things that are unlearnable except when you're there with people who've already learned it, that culture is an important thing to maintain. And maybe there's some peril there.
We can agree, we hope, for renewal where that's concerned,
yeah,
one form or another. Well, I'm sorry, this form leaves us time constrained. That's all the time we have today. Our thanks to Les Hinton, CEO at Dow Jones & Company. We also thank our audience here and on the internet and radio. I'm Quentin Hardy. And now this meeting of the Commonwealth Club of California, the place where you're in the know, is adjourned.